Hey, today we're going to take a look at how we can achieve multi-platform builds so we can pull off something like this, where we build for an AMD 64 chip and an ARM 64 chip, right? If we're going to build dev containers that we need to use across our team, if we know that we're going to use Docker containers that are supported by a wide audience, then this might be something that you're interested in. And we're going to use GitHub Actions to pull this off. I'll walk you through what that looks like. If that sounds cool to you, please feel free to drop a like. If you want to see more videos like this, consider subscribing. And if there's other things you want to see that I'm not covering, please add a comment. I am taking suggestions. All right now we're looking at a Docker file. And this is the same Docker file that I used in a previous video about how to build dev containers. If you're going to be building dev containers, it is a really good idea to build for multiple architectures or as many architectures as your team requires, right? If you're on a Mac and someone else is on a Intel Dell, for example, you're going to need to build for multiple architectures. Now, this strategy will work for any Docker image. It's not just for dev containers, but that's the use case that I have. So I've made a quick change. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to push this change up so that it's building in the background. I'm going to get commit. I'm going to get push. It'll build in the background in GitHub Actions while we walk through the steps required to actually pull this off. So if I come to Chrome, if I come into Chrome and I come to Actions, this should kick off. Yep, there it is. All right, as description labeled the Docker file, that's the commit I just made. So it's running in the background. Let's go back into the code and we'll walk through the actual steps required to pull this off. If you're not familiar with how to set up GitHub Actions, the first thing you need is a YAML file that describes your build, and you need to store that in a .github/workflows directory. So once you have that, you can actually start to build out the steps. Now, I just want to be clear about something. I'm not an expert in this. This is going to be my implementation, and there's a lot of ways to pull this off with multi-platform build. This is just the implementation that I went with. If you have others, please feel free to share them in the comments or link to other resources that other people can use. There are a lot of ways to do this. So the way that I did this, I have a job. Its name is build and push image, right? And it's going to run on push. Like anytime something merges or anytime someone pushes to a branch, this pipeline is going to run. I'm setting two environment variables. The first is the domain of the registry that I'm going to be pushing to. So GHCR, great. I'm pushing to GitHub Container Registry. And then I'm going to set another environment variable, which is the image name. Now, the image name is using a build environment variable, right? That is available to the build. And there's a few of them that we're going to see. This one, github.repository, specifies, or that breaks out into the org and the name of the repository. So org slash name. And using variables like this allows us to use this same build file for other repos. I didn't hard code any specific repo in here, meaning I can take this main.yaml and I can apply it to all of my repos where I need multi-platform builds. Moving on, I've got one job in here, build and push image, right? It's going to run on a Ubuntu machine and I'm going to give it specific permissions. These permissions are going to map to a token that GitHub provides this build process. So the permissions that I'm saying, I'm going to give it access to read the contents of my repo. I'm going to allow it to write to packages in my org, right? So this is the GHCR packages or where we store our images. I'm also going to give it attestation write access and ID token write access. These last two are going to be a little bit out of scope for this video. In fact, there's a few things out of scope for this video that I should mention. One is attestations and the other is tagging. I'm only going to do some very simple tagging. There's a lot we could go into there. All right, so the first step is setting up Docker. So I'm going to use this Crazy Max GH action setup Docker action, right? That's open source. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to pass in a Docker daemon config. You don't have to do this, right? This is kind of future-proofing my build. It's going to use a new feature called Containerd Snapshotter. And what that allows us to do is use a new Containerd storage technique that is more future-proof and in the future might not actually require this configuration. It might be in there by default. That's not necessary for this, but that's what I'm using. Then I'm going to check out this GitHub repository, the repository that I'm building. So I'm going to pull it into the Actions build environment, right, so that we can execute on it. Then I'm going to have a step to log in to the container registry, right? And it's using this Docker login actions. So this is a action that is actually provided by Docker for logging into any Docker registry. I'm using it with this environment variable, right? This pointed back up to ghcr.io. The username is the GitHub actor. So that's the environment, the build environment. The token that I'm using is the one that's provided by the build environment. And remember, that token has these permissions. It can write to GitHub packages. I specified that. So now that we've logged in, I'm going to have another step to extract metadata. This is a build step that you may or may not want to use. What this allows us to do is extract labels and identify different tagging options for our image. So I'm only passing in a very simple option, which is, hey, here's the full URL of the image that we're going to tag. This action, right, Docker metadata action, this is going to dive into the Docker file, pull out labels, dive into the Git flow, pull out tags, and try to build as many tagging options as it can based on the information that's provided. The next is probably the most important step here. It's setting up QEMU, or what I've been saying is QEMU, and I have no idea if I'm the only person that says it that way, but that's what I've been saying in my brain. This allows us to emulate. That's what the EMU stands for. It allows us to emulate different architecture sets so that when we're building, we can build for architectures that aren't actually used in the build environment that we're running on, right? I'm running in Ubuntu. I didn't actually specify which chipset. So what QEMU does, it emulates other chipsets so that we can build for them as build targets. And then here we are at the actual build step. I have build and push my Docker image. So we're going to dive through this one by one. Okay, this step is called push. It uses Docker's, the official Docker build and push action that's been provided by the Docker folks, right? And here are all my options. So the context I'm setting is the root of this repo. We want to push. So once it's done, we're actually going to push it up. And here's the core setting, right? This is the specific setting where I specify what are the platforms I'm building for. Linux AMD 64 and Linux ARM 64. If you want to know what options are available, they're actually the output of this step right here. Once you set up QEMU, you will be able to see all the different options that QEMU supports. Notably, Windows is not listed in here because Windows isn't supported. QEMU looks at the build environment. Again, I'm building on Ubuntu. So if I'm building on Ubuntu, it's not going to be able to build for Windows. It can, however, build for all sorts of different Linux platforms. And that's where I found these options. Provenance false. The reason I set that is when this builds, it also builds for whatever it believes is the current chipset. And because that's not specified, it will show up as an unknown architecture in my build output. I don't want to do that. I just want to have two clearly supported architectures. So provenance false takes care of that. The next thing, I have my tags. Remember, I said I was setting up the metadata step and I'm going to get tags out of there. And because I'm not providing it much information, all it's going to do is provide a tag with the name of the branch. And then I'm also specifying another tag using string interpolation. We have the registry, so ghcr.io / the image name, right? So the org and the repo name, and I'm tagging that as latest. So I'll have two tags coming out of this, the branch name and latest. Those are the two tags that we're going to see in the build output. And then finally, labels, whatever labels that Docker was able to pick up from the Docker file. Finally, we have my last step. Again, this is kind of out of scope. It's generating the artifact attestation. If you want to know more about that, I can make a video. Please leave a comment asking for it. And what that does is it just proves this was built in the environment where we expect it to have been built in. It was built with all the expectations that we have. Again, out of scope for this video. All right, here we are back in the Actions tab, and we can see this is the job that ran 20 minutes ago. Why 20 minutes? Because that last part, that took a really long time to produce, and it took several takes. So here we are. It took 20 minutes. If I come into this build, we can see here's the one job that I have listed in my YAML, and here are all the steps. They all ran successfully. Very cool. So let's see my packages. Let's see the corresponding package that was built with this tofu Ansible dev container. I'm going to click in here and there should be last published 20 minutes ago. Which one? This specific pair of tags, latest and main, published 20 minutes ago, just like the job said. So if I come into main or latest, could come into either one. We can see here's my installation steps and OS Arc. Here are my two platforms that I specified, Linux AMD 64 and Linux ARM 64. So like I said, there's actually quite a few ways to pull this off. This is the way that I did it. And no, I am not an expert, but this is just what I've been able to get working. So if you have other strategies, please share them in the comments. If you have links to other resources, please share them in the comments. If you like this video, please consider dropping a like. If you want to see more like it, consider subscribing. And if there's other things that you want to see that I'm not covering, please add a comment. Let me know what that is. I am taking suggestions. Thanks for watching.